Hello everyone, this is Dr. Kalpana and you are watching my YouTube channel Pharmacy Lessons Made Easy. The topic for today's presentation and the upcoming video is energy losses during the flow of fluids. See, in my previous videos I have uploaded the flow of fluids, how to measure the rate of flow of fluid and the Reynolds number, Bernoulli's theorem in full detail. Now, as the flow of fluid happens, it is associated with certain losses in energy, right? So we shall discuss in detail what are those energy losses, okay, one by one. So let's begin. First thing is energy loss. We should first understand this term. Actually, as we all are aware that as per universal law, energy can neither be created nor it can be destroyed. And energy balance has to be properly maintained. So that means once the fluid is in motion, the fluid will experience energy loss in numerous ways. Like there is friction which is acting side by side of the motion of the fluid. The losses in the fittings, that means how the pipes are fitted, if there is sudden expansion or eddy currents or sudden compression, okay, so that may get compressed like vena contracta and like that. So we shall discuss these energy losses in detail. Actually, as per this law, energy can neither be created nor be destroyed. So once whatever energy we are providing for that particular fluid to move from place X to a place Y, so that energy will help it, that particular fluid to reach from X to Y. But during its motion, it will not be totally dissipated in the motion. It will show friction also and the other losses in terms of heat, in terms of sound energy, like that. So how that losses can be categorized? So majorly there are four different types of losses. They are frictional losses, losses in fittings, enlargement losses and contraction losses, right? So let's discuss all the types one by one. So we shall start with the frictional loss first. When the liquid and the solid are in relative motion during the flow of fluid in the pipes, etc., there is a special case of general law of resistance. Okay, in Bernoulli's equation, the term F has been included to represent energy losses due to friction. If you are able to recall the Bernoulli's equation that we have already studied, it says that the sum of potential energy, kinetic energy and pressure energy at any point is equal to the same at point B. That means pressure energy, potential energy and kinetic energy at point B if it is moving from one place A to another place B, right? So in that particular equation we have done the addition of work W, which is actually the force which is or the work done which is required for a liquid to move from a place A to a place B, right? And we have subtracted the F value, that means the frictional forces, okay? So that loss basically was subtracted in the Bernoulli's equation. So if we are able to recall, so in Bernoulli's equation, this term F has been included to represent the energy losses due to friction. The type of flow fluid also affects these energy losses, okay? So now the type, how the fluid is flowing. So we have defined the Reynolds number and based on that, the type of flow of that particular fluid is decided. That can be laminar or turbulent in nature based on the Reynolds number. So whether the fluid is flowing in the laminar flow or the turbulent flow or the transient flow, that will also affect the loss in energy. This these fractional forces results in the loss of pressure. Basically, if we talk about the fluids, that will include both liquid as well as gases. So to quantitate that, basically the liquid you can quantitate in terms of volume, okay, but in the case of gases, you have to quantitate it in terms of pressure, because the if we talk about the volume of the gases, they cannot be quantitated on their on the basis of the volume they occupy, because they actually occupy the volume of the container in which the gas is packed, right? So the pressure is the index. If that is measured, that will give an idea how much quantity of that particular gas is present in that container, right? So more the amount of that particular gas, more would be the pressure that is exerted. This you can equilibrate it, or you can assume the situation. Suppose you have a tank, fuel tank of your car, and you're putting up the CNG in that. So the as you apply more and more of the CNG amount, the pressure it will be indicated on the indicator of that particular car. So basically the cylinder inside it is of fixed volume, but as the quantity will be increasing, the pressure that is being created by that gas, that is compressed natural gas, CNG, that will also increase. So you can correlate the thing with that, okay? So this pressure drop is actually proportional to the average velocity of the fluid. How much is the flow of that particular fluid is? Okay, the rapidly it is flowing, more pressure it will cause. Its density, of course, the mercury will create a different sort of pressure as compared to water, right? And the length of the pipe through which the fluid is flowing. Okay, so you can notice the length of the pipe once you are doing watering to your plants. So the length actually affects the pressure that will be applied. And it is inversely proportional to the diameter of the pipe, because the wider the diameter of the pipe, the less pressure would be created. Suppose you put your fingertip at the edge of the pipe, then in that case the pressure increases. That means if you are decreasing the viscosity, decreasing the diameter of the pipe, then the pressure will increase. So this is how you can correlate the pressure drop, right? So moving forward, how we can correlate such losses due to the friction, okay, which are actually happening when the liquid is flowing. So fanning equation has been proposed for both viscous as well as turbulent flow. We shall separately consider the case for viscous flow, in which Hagen-Poiseuille equation has been proposed. So first look at this fanning equation. As per fanning equation, delta Pf is equal to 2fu square L rho by Gc into D, where delta Pf is the pressure drop due to friction. Okay, pound per foot square is the unit of it. And small f is the frictional factor, this one. Gc is 32.2 pound mass feet per pound force per second square. The friction factor value changes as per the condition of the pipe. Now, because it is related to the friction, so friction can't be same for every type of material. It can't be same for every type of condition of the pipe. The condition of the pipe is like, if we consider a very brand new steel or cast iron pipe, then the roughness factor would be 1. That means if we are multiplying it with 1, so the value will be the same. So that means there is no such effect of new steel or cast iron pipe on this particular equation. That means friction is not at all playing a major role. But if we take a badly tuberculated cast iron pipe, in that case, the roughness factor will be 2.5. That means in this particular equation, if we put the value, then the amount of the frictional pressure loss, okay, that means the pressure loss due to friction will get multiplied by the factor of 2.5, right? The similar way, the old cast iron or new riveted steel pipe has a roughness factor of 1.4, vitrified pipe or old steel pipe has a roughness factor of 1.6, old riveted steel pipe has a friction factor of 2, smooth wooden pipe has a friction factor of 1.2. Smooth brass, copper or lead pipe has a roughness factor of 0.9. So this is how the friction affect for both viscous as well as the laminar flow fluids. Okay, and particularly for viscous flow fluid, the major equation that is proposed is Hagen-Poiseuille equation, which says that delta Pf value is equal to that delta PF stands for the decrease in pressure, that means the loss in pressure due to the friction. Okay, so that will be equal to 32 multiplied by L U eta upon GC d square. The terms are the same as we have utilized in the previous equation. So in this above discussion, it is considered that the fluid is flowing through a straight pipe. That means there is no fitting loss. Okay, and no sudden enlargement or contraction loss. So this is the condition. In that case, if these factors are null, we are considering only the friction into the picture, then these equations will apply, right? So moving forward to the next one, that is the loss in fittings. That means how the fitting of the pipe. See, if I wish to transfer the gas which is being produced, suppose it is carbon dioxide, into a room in the industry where actually fermentation has to be carried out, okay, in a fermenter. So if I had to transport it, there will not at all be the ideal situation of a straight pipe. You do have certain kinds of fittings or the joints, okay, among the pipes, so that this particular it will reach to this particular fermenter and you can control the flow with the help of valves, like one of the ways, globe valve, okay. So that way you do have certain fittings like T fitting, coupling fitting, elbow fitting, and you do have some valves which will control the flow of fluids, right? So basically these such fittings and the valves will actually lead to loss in energy due to these fittings, and this may be due to the direction change during the fluid flow and the fitting type change during the fluid flow. So Fanning equation, which was proposed for the losses during the flow of fluid in the straight pipes, whenever fittings are introduced into these straight pipes, they cause flow disturbances with additional energy loss due to the flow direction changes, fitting type changes, which cause additional turbulence. So equivalent length of fitting is generally calculated to express this loss. Okay, so this equivalent length concept will come into pictures. So if it would have been a straight pipe, then suppose the length was X, but now the similar length, if replaced with an elbow fitting, then in that case we shall multiply it with the factor of 32. So this is called the equivalent length, right? The same way T fitting has an equivalent length of 90, coupling fitting the equivalent length is almost negligible, and in the case of globe valve, if you see, the equivalent length is 300. That means whatever value in the energy loss you are getting, you have to multiply it with a factor of 300, right? So as an example, globe valve equivalent length is 300. So equivalent length for a globe valve, if we have a pipeline length of 2 centimeters, so this 2 centimeter of a normal straight pipe, if in that case globe valve appears, then that 2 centimeter length would be considered as 6 meter or 600 centimeter length. So that means the globe valve is equivalent to 6 meter straight line for a pipe of length 2 centimeter carrying globe valve. So this is how the loss in fitting actually affects the flow of the fluid and leads to energy losses. The next type of loss is enlargement losses. That means the liquid was flowing with its constant average speed, that is U1, and suddenly the area got enlarged. Okay, the liquid or the fluid got more space for it to flow. So in that case, what will happen? The directional changes for these enlarged cross-sectional area, the fluid has to acclimatize as per this directional change without any disturbance. So if there would be no disturbance, there will not be any loss of energy in that situation if fluid is able to acclimatize. But the velocity of flow at larger cross-section is less than the velocity at smaller cross-section. Okay, that is, U2 will be less than U1. So this will be comparatively less and this will be higher. U2 will be higher, will be lesser than the U1. Okay, so that means once it got the larger area, so it will be getting slowed down in its average velocity. So for sudden enlargement, the energy loss is represented by this formula, which says enlargement loss is equal to delta H, which stands for U1 minus U2 square upon 2GC, right? So here the value is U1 minus U2. U1 is greater than U2, right? So that is why U1 is coming first, and minus U2, and this is squared upon 2GC. Suppose the liquid was flowing at 4 centimeter per second, okay? So this was the velocity, and once it reached here, the value of the average velocity became 2 centimeter per second. So in that case, delta H will be equal to U1, that is 4 square, 4 minus 2 whole square divided by 2GC. So this way we will be calculating the energy losses, okay? So delta H is actually the loss of head, which is attributed to sudden enlargement in the fluid pipe cross-sectional area in meters. So the equivalent length of L, which we substituted in the Fanning equation in order to obtain the energy loss due to fitting. On the contrary, if change in the cross-sectional area is sudden, that we have shown here, eddy current may develop, resulting in energy losses. These losses are greater at such point where there is sudden enlargement as compared to situation where it would have been a straight line pipe. So this we have understood. So far we have covered energy loss due to friction, and the equation that was proposed was Fanning equation for both viscous as well as turbulent flow, and for viscous flow Hagen-Poiseuille's equation. Then we have studied the loss in fitting, which is basically due to direction change or the fitting type changes, and we have utilized the term equivalent length of fitting in this particular case. In case of enlargement loss, we have seen the formula by which we have to calculate the energy losses due to enlargement, and that is represented by delta H, and the formula is U1 minus U2 square by 2GC. Now, this situation can be opposite or just reverse, that despite enlargement, the fluid which was flowing like this got suddenly contracted as some orifice or some sudden break path obstacle has come in its path, right? So what will happen in that case? So while the fluid is flowing through a pipe, and if there is sudden decrease in the cross-sectional area of the pipe, there will be disturbance in the fluid flow. The diameter of the fluid stream will be decreased as compared to the initial diameter. This was the diameter initially, and this is now. So there is a decrease. The position with minimum cross-sectional is termed as vena contracta. So this will be termed as vena contracta. Velocity of the fluid at lesser section will be greater than at the higher cross-section. Okay. So at this particular section, the velocity of this will be greater. Okay, like the way you put your finger in here, suppose, then from the water pipe, the water comes at a higher velocity. Okay, so the velocity here, U2, will be greater than the U1. Okay. Right, when the difference is very large, then in that case we can neglect the U1 also. Thus, due to development of eddy currents owing to sudden contraction, the energy loss will take place, which may be represented by the following expression, that is delta H is equal to K U2 square by 2GC. So if we compare it with the previous equation where U1 minus U2 was taken into consideration, here the case is opposite and U1 is negligible. So if we take the square of a negligible term, suppose we have a negligible value of 0.001. So if we take the square of this term, this will become 0.00001, right? So that way it will be even more less and can be neglected. So when the square term is there, so this will be neglected. That is why this only one term, that is U2, because that was a higher value, okay, that will be retained. U1 can be neglected. So delta H is a loss in head owing to the sudden contraction in the cross section. U2 is the velocity of flow of fluid contraction.
K is a constant whose values depend on the relative cross-sectional area. The value of K is generally 0.3 when the ratio of cross-sectional area is 0.5, but the value is 0.04 when the pipe has rounded turbulence and negligible when the flow is laminar in nature, right? So this is how we can calculate and determine the contraction losses, the enlargement losses, losses in fittings, as well as the frictional losses. So this was all about the energy losses during the flow of fluids. I hope you people like this video, and this will be very helpful for BPharm students who are studying the flow of fluids. I wish you, thank you for your patient listening, and you can click on the like button, do subscribe my channel and share it on social media. Thank you.